Thank you. Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome you to the First Congregational Church on this beautiful Sunday in June. We pray that you will be blessed by what you see and hear and experience this day. I want to wish you a very happy Father's Day to all the dads and granddads and great-granddads and spiritual fathers as well. We do wish you a happiest day today. There are several announcements in your bulletin and on the screen. Be sure to take your bulletin home and keep it in a handy place so you can check for what's coming up during the week. Next Sunday is the monthly luncheon, which will be at Outback Steakhouse. So be sure to let Joe and Marie know if you're going to come so they can have an accurate count for the restaurant. Next Saturday, it is the 22nd, 9 a.m. at Maddie's, is the men's breakfast. And I know you'll be blessed if you go to that. Let us stand for the call to worship, which this morning is Psalm 95, 1 through 7a. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him in thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word. Let us join in singing together hymn number 686.
Thank you.
Most Heavenly Father, we thank you for being our Heavenly Father, our Abba, Daddy, who loves us unconditionally. You made us, you know all about us, and you are right by our side, always. Thank you. Our God, our help in ages past, our God, our help right now, our God, our help tomorrow, and the next day, and the next day, and the next day. What a privilege it is to come and be in your presence and know that you surround us with your love and care every minute of every day. Lord, we thank you for this privilege of knowing you, of having the opportunity to have your word in our homes, in our minds, in our hearts. And Jesus, your disciples came to you and asked you how they should pray. And he answered them, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. As we forgive our brothers, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Remain in attitude of prayer as our praise team comes forward to lead us.
Thank you.
trickle of sufficient flow. There is nothing I shall do.
Thank you. Let us come before our Father, his Father in heaven. Father God, you are so awesome. Completely and totally beyond our comprehension. Thank you for giving us your Son, that we might see an inkling of who you are in him. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for revealing the Father to us. His care, his love, his compassion, his kindness, his mercy. Father, we give you praise, we give you glory, we humble ourselves before you, not worthy of anything that you've bestowed upon us, let alone eternal life. Eternal life that we have now through your Son. Eternal life in the future. Father God, you are so great. You are so wonderful. You are magnificent. And this morning we praise you. We worship you at the bottom here. Those who are watching. We worship you, Lord God, because you are worthy of worship. You are the creator and sustainer of the universe. You are the one who made everything and holds everything together by your word. Father, you have troubled yourself with our pettiness. You see us for who exactly we are, fallen, sinful, and yet, as our sister prayed this morning, unconditional love, unconditional acceptance. You love us, care. So this morning, Father, we bring before you our petitions and those things that labor on our hearts, those concerns that we have. Some of them are well-founded. Some of them, Father, we just simply fail to relinquish into your hands. Forgive us for that. You've told us to be anxious for nothing. Told us not to worry, Lord Jesus, and you do. Forgive us for that. Tell us to turn all these things over to you, knowing that you know what's best for us and for our loved ones. And so, Father, we pray for the sick. We pray for those who are hurting, those who have situations going on right now, this moment, here in this body. First of all, we pray and we ask for healing. We know that you can heal, and so we ask it. That you would heal this very moment. That you would relieve the pain, that you would relieve the suffering, that you would cure the cancer, that you would intervene in a special, miraculous way, Lord. As we see your hand at work in our bodies. Thank you, Father, for providing everything we need. And yet sometimes we worry. Needlessly, we worry. I know that you will provide everything that we need. You take care of your children and you will supply. Help us to be patient with you. Help us to understand that you know what's best for us. So we commit our cares to you. We pray for our loved ones, those who are unsaved, Lord, that you would touch their hearts and draw them to yourself. You know how much we love them. You know how much you care. Help us to be loving and caring as we share your word, share your compassion. Father, we pray for this nation. This nation that has gone far, far away from you. We have turned as a nation from our God. Lord, I pray that you would work in the hearts of leaders, that you would draw us as a nation back to yourself. Forgive us for our apathy. Lord, we pray that you would bring a revival back into this country. Your word would be honored, that you would be honored and lifted up as you should be, as you were. So God, we commit our country into your hands. Father, we pray for those who are protecting us. Pray that you would protect them. Bring them home back safely to their families. Give peace to those who wait. Father, I pray for every father, grandfather, great-grandfather that's here this morning with us. Pray that you would bless them in a very special way. Forgive us for our failures and our shortcomings as dads and grandfathers and great-grandfathers. But at the same time, thank you for the strength and for the wherewithal and the faithfulness that you have given to each of these men to be a dad, to be a father, a grandfather, a leader in our respective homes. Bless each man, Father, I pray. Continue to bless this service. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Yes, Lord.
For loving us, for giving us life. Thank you for these gifts, Lord. We pray that you would multiply them so that your word, your love, might go out from this place and around the world. We ask it for your sake. Amen.
Amen.
Morning.
Good morning.
Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
Hey to you.
Thank you. And we have old fathers, grandfathers, great-grandfathers, great-great-great-grandfathers, if we have any. Uncles, please stand. Pharisee's house brought him, held back at the last appointment. And and standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears, and wiped them with the hair of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is, who's touching him, for she is a sinner." And Jesus, answering, said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." And he answered, "Say it, teacher." "A certain moneylender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii, the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now, which of them will love him more?" Simon answered, "The one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt." And he said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little, loves little." And he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." Then those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sin?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." May God bless the reading of his holy word. God's forgiveness. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 12, we read, "Forgive us our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors." In Luke chapter 11, verse 4, we read, "Forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us." Jesus instructs his followers to ask the Father for forgiveness of sin. God is longing. God's desire is to forgive. God loves to forgive. God is love, and he loves you. And he is longing to forgive. That's his heart's desire. God loves you. God loves me. Please say those words out loud. God loves me. God loves me. God loves me. And he's longing to forgive. That is his heart's desire. As we continue our study in the Lord's Prayer, we come to these verses this week. And it's wonderful because it does focus on our Father, does it not? On Father's Day. First of all, let's begin with, what is sin? What is sin? The reason I pointed out Matthew 6, 12, and Luke 11, 4 is because there's two different words that are used there in Greek. The one is debt. Forgive us our debts. And that's the one we usually pray in our invocation. The Greek word there is ophilema. Ophilema. Which means something that is owed. Something that is due. In Luke chapter 11, verse 4, the word is hamartia. And hamartia means to miss the mark. So with both of these words, we have a clear understanding of what sin is. It is something that is owed to someone and missing the mark. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe you all know that we have all missed the mark. Amen? We have all missed the mark. God created man in his own image. He created man and woman perfect. And man chose to go his own way. Man chose to be his own God. When man chose to be his own God, man died. He didn't die physically immediately. He died spiritually. The relationship that that perfect man and woman had with God Almighty in the garden was broken. That relationship was destroyed. Man was separated from God at that point. What did man choose to do? He chose to hide when God came looking for him. When God found him, what did God do? God made a proper covering for the man and the woman. God took an innocent animal, slew that animal, his blood was shed, and made coverings for the man and for the woman. That is the first sign of an atonement that was made for sin. Sin separates. Sin is missing the mark. Sin is something that is owed, a debt that has to be paid. And God gave a clear picture of that debt being paid when he covered man in the garden. Afterwards, God gave man a set of rules. And he said to man, obey my rules. Obey these standards. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples. And so God spoke. And what did he say? He said, I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself any graven image. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Honor your father and mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. Since I have a pulpit, I'm going to get on the sofa. Covetousness. This is a little sidestep. Covetousness. Wanting something that we cannot or should not have. Covetousness is the standard of the world and one of the basic tenets of the current worldview, dominating the world. The world has been ensnared in a net of covetousness, especially by the means of advertising. You want more. You need more. You must have this. Otherwise, you'll surely die. You deserve this. You're worth it. Every morning when I watch the weather, I see commercial after commercial after commercial about cars. Every single car. Have to have this new car. Necessary. You're worth it. You have a right. Amazing. Covetousness. Back in the day, I remember a phrase that used to be wanting to be like the Joneses. Whoever the Joneses were. The Joneses were the ones that lived down the street. They had a new washing machine, so you had to have a new washing machine. Ladies and gentlemen, there was a time when there were no washing machines. No washing machines. The TV. First it was this big. Remember? And then it was this big. Now, they cover the walls. You must have one. And they're also coming down in size too. Now that's the cool thing. You gotta have one now that's small. Crazy. I say just look at the pictures. Look at the pictures, ladies and gentlemen. Think about this with me, please, just for a moment. Have you ever seen a picture of a Whopper Jr.?
Yeah. Okay.
You've seen a picture of a Whopper Jr.? Have you ever gotten a Whopper Jr. that looks like a picture? Or French fries that look like a picture of French fries? It's a lie. It's a lie. They're all lies. Airbrushed pictures of women with tons of makeup. It's a lie. It's all a lie. And yet the world is born into this covetousness, self-gratification. That's the God of the day. I went to the vitamin store the other day and I got a bottle of vitamins. You know what it was filled with? Half of it was cotton. Half cotton. The bottle's this big and half of it is cotton. They got a little bit of vitamin. It's a lie. It's all a lie. God and the world is born into this lie. God says, do not covet. Anyway, that. What was the purpose behind God instituting the law? Why did God give the law? Well, we're told the Apostle Paul writes, why did the law? It was added because of transgression. The law was added because of sin. But the scripture imprisoned everything under sin. So that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. Now, before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then, the law was our guardian. The law was a guardian. The Greek word is a tutor, a teacher. A servant whose duty was to take the children to school. That's what the word means. So the law was a tutor, a guide, to bring us to school. Paul continues, until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we're no longer under guardian. Faith has come. And those who place their faith in Christ are no longer under the imprisonment of the law. Doesn't mean that we don't follow the Ten Commandments. We do. The law confirms and establishes the reality of sin in order for it to be clearly and plainly recognized. We all know that something is wrong. Deep down in our souls, our conscience convicts us. The law acted as a servant to lead us to the solution which God has provided for our sin. He himself became a king in the person of his son. Jesus lived a perfect sinless life. He shed his blood to atone for our sins, the sins of the world, and then he rose again from the dead to validate that redemption is secure. What is sin? We, I think, sometimes underestimate really what sin is. The heinous nature of sin. You know what sin does, ladies and gentlemen? It tears relationships apart. It tears relationships apart. Relationships between people, relationships with God. Jesus taught us that if a man looks on a woman with lust in his heart, he's committed adultery with her. If we unjustly get angry with someone, we've already committed murder in our hearts toward that person. Why did Jesus tell us this? To make us feel guilty? To have us running around with guilt trips on us? No. He told us this so that we might understand the hideousness of sin and how pervasive it is. Let me ask you a question. What are the consequences? What are the consequences of sin?
Death.
Consequences of sin is death. Absolutely. But there are further consequences of sin. What are the consequences of millions upon millions upon millions of pornographic magazines that began flooding our nation and the world in the 50s and the 60s? We are seeing the consequences today. The internet is flooded with porn. What are the consequences of removing the Bible from classrooms throughout our nation? What are the consequences? There are horrible, horrible consequences of sin. I have here a copy of the New England Primer. The New England Primer. This was used in every single school in our nation back in 1777. The New England Primer. This is how children learn to read. They used the New England Primer to learn to read. In the very first page, we read a divine song of praise to God for a child by the Reverend Dr. Watts. Here's what they used to say every single day. And they repeated it out loud. Children, little children, how glorious is our heavenly King who reigns above the sky. How shall a child presume to sing his dreadful majesty? How great his power is none can tell, nor think how large his grace, nor men below or saints that dwell on high before his face. Nor angels that stand round the Lord can search his secret will, but they perform his heavenly word and sing his praises still. Then let me join his holy train, and my first offerings bring. The eternal God will not disdain to hear an infant sing. My heart resolves, my tongue obeys, and angels shall rejoice to hear their mighty Maker's praise sound from a feeble voice. That's how they opened in school every single morning. 1777, they were taught, this is what they prayed. Firstly, it's entitled, The Young Infant's or Child's Morning Prayer. Almighty God, the maker of everything in heaven and earth, the darkness goes away, and the daylight comes at thy command. Thou art good, and dost good continually. I
thank thee that thou hast taken such care of me this night, and that I am alive and well this morning. Save me, O God, from evil all this day long, and let me love and serve thee forever, for the sake of Jesus Christ, thy Son. Amen. That is the prayer that they prayed. Today, we have young people going into schools with machine guns and mowing down other children. The consequences of sin. At night, the infant's young child's evening prayer. O Lord God, who knowest all things, thou seest me by night as well as by day. They use this old English, right? I pray thee for Christ's sake, forgive me whatsoever I have done this day, and keep me all this night while I am asleep. I desire to lie down in divine care and to abide forever under thy blessing, for thou art a God of all power and everlasting mercy. Amen. That's what they were taught to pray both morning and evening. And it was done in every single school throughout this country. That's how we grew up. There are consequences to sin. What are the consequences of free love? Remember free love in the 60s? Free love. The economic rise of divorce, rape, and incest. How many fatherless homes do we have today? What has been the rise of divorce? I remember in my parents' day, nobody divorced. You do not divorce. Fatherless homes. Single moms. The objectification of women. Many women have bought into this lie. The fashion industry has taken over. And it's not how much you can wear, but how much can you get away with not wearing. Why? To bring attention, to lure the eyes of men. Ladies, don't buy into the lie. It's a lie. Women should be lifted up. Women should be honored. Women should be respected. June 14th, 2019. When was that? Yesterday.
Friday.
June 14th, 2019. Quote, despite the recent sharp declines in sexual assault, the FBI puts the forcible rape rate at 3 times higher than in 1960, the Chicago Tribune. On Friday, forcible rape is up 3 times higher than in 1960. Takes two to tango.
Yes.
Men, watch your eyes. My eyes are not my eyes. These eyes do not belong to me. These eyes have been purchased with blood. Jesus Christ died for my eyes. They belong to him. But when they do stray, we've sinned against the holy God and against our fellow human beings. We've missed the mark before God payment is due. And payment was made. He says to his disciples, pray this prayer. Forgive us our sins, Father. Forgive me, Father. Father, forgive me. What should be our attitude when we ask for forgiveness? We should be broken. When we understand what sin really is, we should be broken. Behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she learned that he was reclining at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought another basket of flask of ointment. What was she doing? She was broken. This woman was broken and torn, knowing who she was, knowing what she had done. She came to Jesus. It was an affront to walk even into the Pharisee's house. She did it. She walked into the Pharisee's house, and she came before Jesus, and she wept at his feet and covered his feet with her tears. And then she kissed his feet. She kissed his feet. She was broken. She regretted. She was remorseful. She was humble. She was sorrowful. But also, there was gratitude. Gratitude. So, one letter, and two debtors, Jesus said, one of 500, the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled both their debts. Which of them loves him more? Simon said, well, obviously, the one who was forgiven more. Gratitude. Thankfulness. We've been forgiven a lot. We have sinned a lot, and we've been forgiven much. God's forgiveness, we should be grateful. We should be thankful. Thankful for the forgiveness that we have. When we come to God, he instantly forgives us. Why? Not because we're good, but because he sees us through the blood. We're covered by the blood of the Lamb. Thankfulness. Total surrender. What did she do? She took ointment, an alabaster full of perfume. That was expensive. She used to use it to cover her body between each man that she had. She no longer lived that life. So she took the perfume and covered the Savior with it and anointed him, because she knew she wasn't going back to what she had been doing. Total surrender. Her life was now in the hands of the one who loved her. Repentance. Jesus said, I tell you, your sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. She loved much. When we trust Jesus Christ to be our personal Lord and Savior, sins are cleansed and removed forever. God told his disciples daily, daily, we need to ask for forgiveness. Daily. Psalm 103, verses 10 through 13. Psalm 103, 10 through 13. He does not deal with us according to our sins. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion for his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. When you ask for forgiveness, your sins are removed as far as the east is from the west. This is a new covenant. This is what Jesus spoke about. A new covenant. The old covenant is passed away. There's a new covenant. Blood of bulls and goats is no longer necessary. We have the blood of Christ. Jesus paid for our sins. He died for you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you unconditionally. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what has happened in your life. He loves you. We need to ask for forgiveness. Why do we need to ask for forgiveness? Well, obviously, in order to get right with God, He's made atonement for our sins. We also need to ask for forgiveness because we still sin. We still sin. The church is not made up of perfect people. The church is made up of sinners. You and I are still sinners, even though at the same time we are saints. But we're still sinners. So if you're looking for perfection in the body of Christ, in the church, you're in the wrong place. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't be perfect. We should aim for perfection. We should emulate the Lord Jesus Christ. But still, we sin. So we need to ask for forgiveness. We need forgiveness every single day. We need forgiveness every single day. Not only forgive us, but forgive our dead, those who have sinned against us. Forgive those who have sinned against us. Why is it so difficult to forgive others? Why is it so difficult to forgive others? Well, there are a number of reasons. You've been hurt. Sometimes you are hurt pretty bad by what others say, by what others do. I shared a story with you about the beatings I used to get from my father and how I could not forgive him. So I didn't know how to forgive. But when I found out how to forgive, I forgave. It's necessary that you forgive those who wrong us. It's necessary to forgive others. You must forgive. God wants to forgive you. God loves you unconditionally. Let me ask you a question. If God loves you unconditionally, if God accepts you just the way you are, why would you not accept the person who's seated at the back of the church? Or the person who's seated at the front of the church? Why would you not forgive those who've offended you? You've offended God, I've offended God. It's necessary for us to forgive. The Bible tells us if we're not willing to forgive, there's something wrong with our relationship with God. We need to forgive. Let me ask you a question. What would happen if nation forgave nation? What would happen? What would happen if race forgave race? What would happen? What would happen if neighbor forgave neighbor? What would happen if fathers forgave? What would happen if mothers forgave? What would happen if children forgave? What would happen if friends forgave? What would happen to our world if everyone forgave everyone else? Jesus said, forgive your enemies. Jesus said, love your enemies. What would happen to Middletown, New York, and the neighboring towns around us if everyone forgave everyone else? What would happen? Can you imagine? Can you imagine? Here's what I want you to do. Everyone have a bulletin? Let me see your bulletin. Everyone has a bulletin, right? Pull it out. Go like this. Everyone has a bulletin? Fantastic. Right in front of you, there should be a pencil. In the pew. There should be a pencil in the pew. Do me a favor, grab a pencil with your bulletin. And what I want you to do is that I want you to write down the name of someone that you are going to forgive this week. Write down the name of someone you're going to forgive this week. Someone who's wronged you. Someone who's hurt you. Someone that you're holding a grudge against. I want you to write their name down. And this week, with God's help, forgive them. Forgive them. When we ask for forgiveness, we have an assurance that we are forgiven. We are assured that forgiveness has been given to us. God loves and accepts you unconditionally. Listen to me. Listen closely. God forgave you your sin before you were born. Before you came into the world, your sins were forgiven. In the sight of God, 2,000 years ago in time and space, Christ died for your sin. We are now in the year 2000 and whatever. He died for your sin 2,000 years ago, before you were born. Unless we have someone here who's very, very old. 2,000 years ago, your sins were paid for. He knew you would come into the world. He created you, and he brought you into the world. And he loves you unconditionally. No conditions. God loves you. God forgave you. He loves you unconditionally, and you are accepted by God. Do you believe this? Do you believe that God accepts you totally? Do you believe that God accepts you unconditionally? Do you believe that there is nothing that you have done or can do that would thwart the love of God? He died for you. He's alive for you. And he accepts you unconditionally. It doesn't matter what you've done. This woman was caught in adultery, in the very act of adultery. They found her, they caught her. I guess somebody walked in on it. They brought her out and they threw her on the ground in front of Jesus. They said to Jesus, okay, Jesus, what are you going to do? Moses taught us that what we should do with this woman is stone her to death. What did Jesus say? He said to them, these religious people, he said to them, whoever views without sin casts the first stone. And he bows down, I guess he kneels down, and he starts writing in the dirt with his finger. You know what I think he was writing? I think he was writing unconditional love. Unconditional love. So none of these religious people were able to pick up the stone because they all knew that they had sinned. So the woman stands up. And Jesus says to her, who's left here? Who's going to throw the first stone? She says, there's no one, Lord. So what did Jesus say to her? No. Oh, you must go and do. And you must And you must go and do this, and you must go and do that, and you must go and do this, and you must go and do that. Is that what he said to her? It's not what he said to her. He said to her, not even white and never you. Go and sin no more. God loves you unconditionally. God loves you unconditionally. At the heart of God is the desire to give and forgive. Richard Foster. At the heart of God is the desire to give and forgive. I want every head bowed, every eye closed. And I want you to say these words. Every head bowed, every eye closed. God loves me. God loves me unconditionally. God has always loved me unconditionally. Father in heaven, we thank you for your great love towards us. We thank you that you made a way. You gave your Son so that we might be forgiven. Father, forgive us our sins. Forgive us, Father, and help us.
Yes,
we need your help, we need your strength, we need your guidance, we need the filling of your Holy Spirit. Fill us with the Holy Spirit, Lord God. Help each and every one here, Father. Help us to forgive as you have forgiven us. Help us to forgive one another. Help us to forgive our enemies. Help us to forgive those who have abused us. And give us peace, your peace. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Please turn to your hymnal. Close again. And me too. He loves you unconditionally. He's given everything for you. So that you and I might have a relationship with him. Him whom much has been forgiven. A person who loves much. In number 92.
Thank you.
us. Help us to forgive and be forgiven. Help us, Lord. Take us this day and use us for your honor and glory. Fill us with your Holy Spirit.
Yes,
in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.